Hi, and welcome back to our studies in the Gospel of John. We are already to chapter 7, and that is where we'll begin today. May I share with you what I consider the theme verses of the entire book, and it is a great summary. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. That comes at the tail end of the entire gospel, and a very powerful two verses together. The whole reason that this is written, that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah, the Anointed One. And by believing, we have eternal life through his name. So this is where we are. We'll be finishing up our second sub-area, chapters 5, 6, and 7, claims by the Son of God. And then we'll be headed on to the next one. Okay, what do we need to learn and what do we need to see here? Here are the claims that have been made and will be made. First of all, he at a feast, he says, "I am life." In chapter 6, he says, "I am bread. I am the bread of life." And then in this chapter, he is the thirst quencher at the Feast of the Tabernacles. And that we see when he gets into debate and explaining and sharing who he is with religious leaders. So let's break this chapter down into two. It's Jesus and his faithless brothers and sisters we could throw into here in Galilee, and that is Jesus and the Feast of the Tabernacles in Jerusalem. So let's read scripture together. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry, meaning he wouldn't walk among the Jews, especially the established or the religious body of them, because the Jews sought to kill him. The phrasing after these things is about 6 months after chapter 6. So we're moving along in time. We can see the Galilean area, the cities up above, Capernaum, of the Sea of Galilee. All right, the Feast of Tabernacles took place October 14 through 21 in 28 AD, and that's when we are. And so here's the second verse. Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. And we can find what that is in Leviticus chapter 23. Let me read these four verses to us, and it'll give us a good explanation because I'm going to share in the next lesson some pictures. And you shall take on the first day the boughs of goodly trees, branches of palm trees, and the boughs of thick trees, and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God 7 days. So this feast is 7 days. And you shall keep it a feast unto the Lord 7 days in the year. It shall be a statute forever in your generation. So it's a national holiday. You shall celebrate it in the seventh month. You shall dwell in booths 7 days. All that are Israelites born shall dwell in booths, that your generations may know that I made the children of Israel to dwell in booths when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. So a short explanation about this holiday lasting 7 days is that it is a remembrance of God bringing and delivering them out of the hands of Pharaoh and in bondage in Egypt, and God's watch, care, and protection over 40 years, because that's pretty much when they would stop the march basically around in circles in the wilderness. They would set up camp, and the people would have to make booths or small homes, like very, very large tent areas. Okay, with that in mind, let's continue. Now since this is about his brothers, and we'll be talking about his sisters shortly. His brothers therefore said unto him, "Depart hence, and go into Judea, that your disciples also may see the works that you do." So they're up near the Nazarene, Nazareth area where they went back and lived, and they've grown up there. His brothers and sisters and Jesus came out of there. He says, now go down to Judea and do your miracles and let your disciples see that and see what you do, etc. We can find about these brothers in Matthew 12, and about his sisters are mentioned in Matthew 13. All right, and here are those two references. While he yet talked to the people, behold, his mother and his brothers stood without, desiring to speak with him. Then one said unto him, behold, your mother and your brothers stand without, desiring to speak with you. All right, now we go on to the next chapter. Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas, or Jude? This was not Judas Iscariot. And his sisters, are they not all with us? All right, so we have some good explanations of here. And what do we know? And that's what this lesson is about, or who are his brothers and sisters. And then we'll finish the other verses that deal with them. But what do we know biblically about his brothers and sisters? Well, we know their names, James and Joseph, and Judas or Jude, and Simon. This is not Simon Peter. This is not Judas Iscariot. This is not Joseph the father, but he's named after him. And nor is it James, the brother of John. So this is another James. All right, the word sisters that we used in the read in the last verse in Matthew 13, verses 55-56, shared with us, there are no names, but we will say there are at least two. He had two sisters. How do we know that? Because the word sisters is plural. It just didn't say his brothers and his sister, meaning one. So we know he had at least two, but their names are never mentioned. James went on to become the pastor. Think of that a minute. They are unbelievers right now in this time frame of Scripture. They cannot accept in their minds and their hearts. They don't see Jesus as the Messiah at all. And they get sort of feisty over it sometimes. But James went on to become the pastor of the Church of Jerusalem at Pentecost. And later on, he was killed. He had a short life after that just to please the Roman officials. And we read about him in Acts 12 and also in Galatians chapter 1. Then Jude wrote the book of Jude. It's a short book, almost to Revelation. And in the very first verse, he tells us he is the brother of James, which that gives us the connector that they are brothers there. So we know the siblings of Jesus did not believe he was a Messiah for most of his life. In John 7, they taunted him. And of course we're there, and we're going to read that shortly. They wanted him to prove he was the Messiah in Matthew 12. It's found in Mark 3. It's found in Luke 8, and we're not going to those passages. We find out later on that they are believers in the book of Acts and join with the disciples and others in prayer and supplication right before Pentecost. So we say amen to that and praise the Lord. And then Paul in 1 Corinthians 9 implies that they were all married. So I'm giving you some verses to go explore and see what you turn up with. Now let's finish what Scripture has to say about them. For there is no man that does anything in secret, and he himself seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. And so Jesus all along has been talking to Pharisees about, you need to do everything open. You do things behind closed doors and in the dark. You plot things and you're up to no good. He said, and Jesus would tell the Pharisees to this point, I do everything in the open. And so the brothers pick up on this and he says, no, nobody that's the real McCoy does anything in secret. They have to be transparent. And they're not saying that in a nice way. They're saying, you go down there and you let them know who you are. And he himself seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. So if you're really Messiah and you've got powers and signs, open up to the world. Quit taking a back seat and just holding back, because Christ would say, my time has not yet come. The timing was everything. Time was in God's hands, not his brothers and sisters. For neither did his brothers believe in him. And this is emphatic about their unbelief. And if I read this correctly from the Greek, it would read this: for neither did his brothers believe in him. None of them did. Not a bit. Then Jesus said to them, my time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. Ready in the sense of what? You can believe. And my time in the Greek says, my opportunity is not yet come. The timing is not right for me to do what you're suggesting. And then he says, but your time is always ready. The disciples could associate with the world at any time. They also could believe on him. Verse 7, the world cannot hate you because they don't claim to be a Christian, but me it hates, because I testify it that the works thereof are evil. And how true that is of all generations. And the Lord says, the world, you know, if you fit in, the world's not going to hate you, because you're part of it. You can be quiet and just live your life, but unless you take a stand, the world's not going to bother you. But Jesus said, the world, it hates me, because I testify it and I reveal that it's evil. Go you up unto this feast, Jesus is talking. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time or the opportunity is not yet full come. And yet, in the Greek, means complete control of the situation. What Jesus is saying, everything is under control, but you go ahead without me. You go up. And my time, my opportunity, everything's under control. We'll see. So verse 9 says, when he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee. And the last verse that we have, but when his brothers were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as if it were in secret. So this was an interesting encounter and a good opportunity for us just to look up and to share some of the things about his brothers. Nothing really on his sisters at this point. And this confrontation was sort of rough. The brothers held their ground, but they listened to Jesus and they didn't go ahead and move to Jerusalem and went down there for the feast like they should have. And then it's almost like as soon as they left, I'm almost thinking when they got out of sight or he knew they were far enough ahead, then he began his trip down towards there. And he just didn't want to go into the public and parade into Jerusalem, where he was known from the outskirts of the city, because there was something really important coming up. All right, I thank you for letting me share that with you. The book of John has some great stories, and this is important too. And I think one of the keys things that I would just leave you with, if you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, are you just fitting into the world? Are you just fitting into your church? Are you in a comfort zone? When God calls us to take a strong stand, a better stand, to share the Lord Jesus Christ in the culture that we live in, the world that we walk, and we know we're going to get kickback on this and pushback, but it's important that we obey the Lord and we love him. Because we love him, we speak for him, we live for him, and we share him. Lord, thank you so much for this section of the Gospel of John as we get underway in a new chapter. We pray, Father, that you would help us to obey and to follow our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. May we be bold in our lives and in our witness. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you so much. God bless you, and I'll see you in verse 11.